in the last session you have something like
something like
50 participants, which are very much, and that's is a great success of your summer school right here.
Thank you.
So actually, shall we start?
The connection get lost, so I think, yeah.
Let's wait for 2-3 minutes.
Yes.
We have lost the connection, so participants may be joining. Okay.
So let me see. I already share my screens.
Yes, it is visible.
Waiting some more to come in.
Yes, sir.
So in the meanwhile, I have also one PhD position right here in the area of quantum computing. If someone interested, of course, he can contact me right here. I will also explain a little bit more about it in my lecture. You give me a big topic, quantum algorithm. Of course, I cannot speak about all quantum algorithms which are out there because there are already too many right here, but I will address one or two and give some, I hope I have enough time for it to come, to also some applications of this quantum algorithms in the area of optimizing transaction schedules. There we apply Cover Search mainly, and I hope I can get right here to the point. In the beginning, I will have
Let me introduce you, Sam, to the participants.
Yes.
Okay, he's a professor in University of Lübeck, Germany. He has received his diploma degree in informatic computer science and the doctorate degree from the University of Paderborn in 2002 and 2005 respectively. His PhD thesis deals with query reformulation for the XML standard, XPath, XSLT and XQuery. After that, he had worked at the University of Innsbruck as a postdoc. Since June 17, 2019, he is an adjunct professor. He worked in the European projects like B2B Ecom, Memphis, ESG, and the TripCon. He was a member of DAWG W3's working group, which developed SparkQL. His research area are data management in the cloud, P2P, web, and especially semantic web, query processing, optimization, power processing, replication, caching, compression, indexing, parallel and distributed computing, logical tester, subset tester, intersection testers, modern hardware architectures such as FPGA, many core CPU, GPU, and smart SSD, and quantum computing. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much for the kind introduction right here. I will send into the chat the slides such that you can also look for them. And I have also given a lecture right here. I just about quantum computing starting right here. The slides are also available. Maybe these resources are quite well for you. I hope so, that they are helpful. I just posted into the chat so that you can access them also directly. So today, I will talk about quantum algorithms. As I said, also already before, I will give a quick wrap up. I want to have quick wrap up of what we. Maybe you heard already, but maybe it summarizes quite well all the stuff and give me also the basics for what I speak later on. And I will go on to the application areas of optimizing transaction schedules. As you already said, I'm a database guy. So right here, such that I also have some connections to these areas. I must find a way from research to quantum computing and the other way around. And that's what I want to try to give it right here. So of course, quantum mechanics, you already heard this many times in your summer school already, that is about the mechanics of light and matter at the atomic and subatomic scale. It's very different from daily life right here, daily life experience of physics. And but that's also the better why we can use it in an extraordinary way for computation. That's there the point. And the idea is maybe relatively old, you could say, right here, because it was already proposed 1982 by Feynman, which first proposes the concept of quantum computers right there. Just to make the hint, you have here a lot of references in my slides, and also that's also the same type in my lecture slides, where you can access very often the original sources. So for example, you can just click on here below the lay, the link to the originally published paper from Feynman and co can beat further. So maybe that is also some things where you can go on and check all the things by yourself, by self-studying the things. You know, there are a lot of reference, you just have to click on them. And about 37 years later, I think we already heard this right here in the summer school, Google announces quantum supremacy. Later on, all the researchers in the quantum computing areas are a little bit more careful and don't speak about quantum supremacy right here, but maybe something like quantum advantage, because they especially claimed that, they solved a problem in 200 seconds on their 53-bit qubit chip processor Sycamore, which you especially need in the classical world, on a classical supercomputer, on the world's fastest supercomputer, IBM Summit, where you need 10,000 years. And of course, IBM is also in the area of quantum computing. Maybe most of you know it. They did much effort to show that Google was not the first which showed quantum supremacy. Some weeks later, they already claimed, okay, it's not 10,000 years, it's 2.5 days on a classical supercomputer with another better classical algorithm, of course, than it was used by Google. And even later, something like 2 years later, some other researchers claimed or showed that they only need 15 hours on a 512 GPU clusters, and they make the estimation that if they would have an exaflops supercomputer with exaflops performance, then they would need only a few dozens of seconds. So even faster than Sycamore, you know? And that already shows with quantum computers, you can do a lot. You must be careful. Maybe the classical algorithms and CPU and GPUs and so on are also very powerful. And maybe you can do many things in the classical world, even better than on the quantum computer. So be very careful by this. But when you look at it, at the effects of it, it was very good that we have this discussion, because the discussion intensifies excessive hype about the current state of quantum technology so far there. So very many become aware that quantum computers are on the road to have productive results and so on, maybe get some results which are not toy examples anymore, because in most things it's still like this. So on the other hand, you see there are a lot of competitors to quantum computers, and we don't have to forget them. Just we have, because we just have quantum computers and can deal with them, the other also are there, and we can apply them, get them working on our problems right here, like many core CPUs, which are something like 64 cores or something like that, or GPU clusters, so one GPU card, there you have computational cores, right here, computational units in the area of 5,000, that you can have big clusters of them, and FPGAs, where you have where you even have a good interconnection network, where you can configure the interconnection network right here to do your computation such that you have data pipelines which you can process. FPGAs are maybe in this sense, not similar to quantum computers, but you can put their place on them, a circuit right here, configure a circuit, and that you can do also on a quantum computer. And there you have different types of quantum computers. There are many, many physical realizations of quantum computers. I don't want to speak about them right here, because that would also take several lectures to go on into all the details right here. But the main two differences are maybe universal quantum computers, which are gate-based, where you can process quantum circuits on it, and also quantum annealers, where you have these QBO problems, where you can oversimplified words, where you can do the same as with simulated annealing. Now, as I said, that is oversimplified. And you must place here, and you must always look and check, okay, which problem I should solve on the quantum computer, which on a FPGA, GPU, many cores, right here. And not all, or it doesn't make sense, processing all problems on the quantum computer. There are certain problems which you can deal with much better than with other on the quantum computer. Okay, here we have the same, again, a slide between, or showing the differences between the universal quantum computer, where you have the gate-based approach, a quantum circuit you can put on it. You already saw it, for example, on the previous in the previous tutorial, and you can go for quantum annealing if you have some so-called QBO problem. I will speak about it later on, where you can have some formula, some cost function, and you want to minimize it. Just to wrap up the differences between the classical and the quantum world, we see that in the classical world, we have the bit, the binary digit, it's a two-level system. In the quantum world, you have the quantum bit, it's a qubit. The basis is also a two-level system, but now you have basis states, and you can put the quantum state in a linear combination of both states. That's the main stuff right here. And then you can do calculations with the quantum logic gates. So it performs on one or more qubits to change the quantum state of a single qubit. It's very much analog, the analogum to the classical world, where you have the digital logic gate. And for example, you have here the knot, but now the new point is that if you look at the not quantum gate, or also called Pauli X gate, that you not only have here the basis states, which are inverted, but you can also put this linear combination of states inside it. So you have an amplitude for the basis state 0 and amplitude for the basis state 1. If you measure, then you this determines, of course, the square of it, the probabilities for measuring this or that basis state. But the NOT operation now exchanges the amplitude and thus also the probabilities for the basis state. So the probability of the basis state 0 becomes the probability, the amplitude of the basis state 1 and vice versa right here. And that, I think, in the last tutorial, in the last lecture of the summer school, it was shown in a very good way. We also have then the mathematical model. It's just a model. It's not like this that in the quantum computers, you have a lot of Bloch spheres inside. But with the Bloch sphere, you can visualize the quantum states. It's just on the surface of the Bloch sphere right here, where on the polars, you have the basic states 0 and 1 right here. And you can do calculations. And in most times, it is some rotation into the in the Bloch sphere. And the measurement will be later on that it collapses to the basis state 0 or 1. And so we come to the measurement and observation. You can also do measurements and observations in the classical world. You can just look, okay, is a bit now, is it deleted or is it set? So is it 1 or 0 right here? And the measurement, you could say like this, okay, you have a box right here. You don't know what is inside and you just open it and you see then the state, you know, 0 or 1. And in the classical or in the quantum world, excuse me, in the quantum world, it's pretty the same. So you do a quantum measurement right here before, the quantum state is in a box. You can't see it. It's shown here transparent that you can look inside, but you can't see it. And you look inside, okay, is it in the basis state 0 or is it in the basis state 1? You know? And you just open the box one time, look inside right here, and the state is not destroyed if it is before also in a basis state. But if it is not in a basis state, in some other quantum superposition, somewhere visualized on another point in the surface, on the surface of on the Bloch sphere, not in one of the basis states, then the superposition state collapses to 0 or 1. According to some certain probabilities. So it will be only 0 or 1, not something between. You don't know what is this quantum superposition right here. Of course, in theory, you can calculate it. In the previous tutorial, it was shown quite well how you can do this right here. You can also measure, there are also measurements according to some other axes. There you have other probabilities for this or that state, but that are only minor things. Already with this, you can have commercial viable hardware right here, for example, to random numbers where you can bring one qubit into superposition. We already heard in the previous tutorial, just apply the Hadamard gate on the basis state 0, and afterwards do a measurement. Then on a perfect quantum computer, but quantum computers are always not perfect, but on a perfect quantum computer, you would have exactly the probability half-half that you will measure the probability for 0 or 1. Right here. So the quantum superposition will collapse to 0 or 1, to the basis state 0 or 1, when you measure it. So you don't know the quantum superposition. But right here of one qubit, but typically you can prepare a lot of sets of identically prepared qubits and then measure them all, you know, have a lot of shots, so-called shots on a quantum computer. And with that, you can approximate the state of the quantum superposition which you get there. Because you measure the probabilities in all axes right here, and you get here the angels in the Bloch sphere. And the angels in the Bloch sphere determines the quantum state. So that's why in quantum computers, you sometimes, or very often, you don't just measure one time or do the computation one time, but do the computation 100 times or 1,000 times to see to get the probabilities for this or that state, to really get the result right here. And another principle is the no-cloning theorem of one qubit. It doesn't matter so much for my presentation, so I just will go over it very quickly, but you can, with that, or it states that you cannot do independent copies of one qubit. That's the point. You cannot do independent copies of one qubit. They are always, you could say, entangled. You can maybe determine with a lot of identically prepared qubits and a lot of measurements somehow the approximation of the quantum superposition, and maybe can later on bring also one qubit into that position with some other operations that you can do. But you cannot have some gates which do a copy right here, an independent copy right here. But you can do entanglements. And that you basically do with CNOT operations, which was also the topic of the previous tutorial. So there we are right here. So here we have still the NOT operation, which you can see as rotation in the Bloch sphere. Of course, as I said, in the quantum computers are not Bloch spheres. It's physically done. There are physical phenomena right here without Bloch spheres, but with many other physical phenomena you can use, but the effects are the same as in the Bloch sphere right here. You can imagine maybe the calculation of the Bloch sphere in nature. It's, of course, in another way, but it visualizes the operations and the effects quite well. And I think in the last tutorial, we already had the CNOT gate where you have the rotation matrix and can do the calculations for it right here, dependent on some control C qubit. If it is set, then it will. The operation, the gate will change the target qubit right here. And there will be also if you have some quantum superpositions, it will be also changed accordingly. So for example, if you have 0, 1 and 1, 1 as quantum superposition with equal probabilities, it will change the probability of 1, 0 or 1, 1 to 1, 0 right here. And the other, it will remain the same. And the nature of quantum logic gates are that most operations are reversible. So you can have the same or maybe other operations right here, and you can get back to the same state. Again, also quite important aspect right here. So applying two times CNOT retrieves the original input right here, bringing, do the rotation in the plosphere and coming back to the original input, except of the measurement, which is of course not reversible. And with this, you have the entangled qubits, where you just apply one CNOT right here on some input, and the other maybe in the correlated state, you have the basis state zero right here, and you get here pretty much the same output as the input. And in the anticorrelated case, it's the opposite right here. And you can also, again, bring in some superposition right here and then get also some certain result right here. Dependent on just calculations with rotation matrix, you can, in theory, get to know what is the result right here after the CNOT gate. And what is very interesting is to know that even if the entangled qubits are at different locations, they are still entangled. That means if one qubit is measured, then the other collapses also to one basis state. If it is correlated or anticorrelated or something between. And because they are still endangered, even if they are at different locations afterwards, it's also called quantum teleportation. And the interesting point is that this phenomena appears to happen instantaneously, ignoring speed of light. And it's somehow, I would say, an open question in physics how this can happen. It was already experimentally verified 2017, for example, for distances of up to 1,200 kilometers. So really much at the exactly time the other qubits, entangled qubit, collapses also to the to one of the, not to one, dependent if it is correlated or anticorrelated to the corresponding basis state. But what maybe computer scientists need to know is that succeeding operation on entangled qubits do not change the state of the other entangled qubits if the operation is not a measurement. So you can do their further calculations with it right here. And that this phenomena, as I said, is very important. It's, for example, used in some protocols for quantum cryptography, where you can, where you can exchange secret keys, something like that. Of course, if you have a lot of operations placed together, you will have this, circuit view on the computation. So for example, the digital circuits, there you have here a NAND gate right here, a lot of NAND gates put together, and we have here the full adder examples. You know, you have 2 bits input and a carry bit input, and you get the sum right here. So 0, 0 becomes 0 in the sum, 0, 1 becomes 1 in the sum, and you have the carry bit additionally right here. That's very basic, but what is interesting to know is maybe that you can do also the same with a quantum computer. there may be, you use other other gates. So you use Toffoli gates and CNOT gates right here. And but you can do, yeah, you can feed in the same basis state 0 and 1 and get the same outputs right here as in the digital world. But you can do also superpositions, use them as input right here. And the output is then, as you then expect, or very interesting to know that, for example, if you feed in anything to A and B is anticorrelated to A, right here, it's expressed here with some circuit representation of the anticorrelated but of entanglement of the Bell states right here, then the sum will be always there one and the carry bit zero if the carry bit is before also zero. that is very interesting to know. So you can do also arbitrary calculations with the quantum computer, but maybe you can just, or you use them, you should use them for some problems where you can speed up your processing according in comparison to the classical world. If you look at the timeline of quantum computers, then you see somehow an exponential quo in the number of qubits. So here we have a logarithmic scale on the y-axis. Here is the number of qubits. And here you have the year right here. And here you see the quantum computers of the different competitors, of the main competitors right here, I would say. So quantum annealing, it was quite early. It was the first commercially available quantum computers was built by D-Wave. Quantum annealing, as I said, is not gate-based. I will come to it also in this lecture right here. And you see there already many qubits are supported up to over 5,000 right here in the moment and 2024, it is announced that it will be something like 7,000. If you look at the main competitors like IBM and Google, they have also a straightforward timeline, roadmap for quantum computers. So you see that quantum computers will be very much more important than before. You can process many more problems on quantum computers as before. And okay, they are still hunting for very good applications already now to show it, but there's definitely the road that maybe, that of course is a hope of the quantum computer vendors that they can solve problems to change the world right here with their type of computer. So IBM and Google are at the superconducting cooling all the stuff down right here to the absolute minimum decrease right here or near to it. And you see that they have a roadmap. Google, for example, in the end of the decade will be by something like 10,000 qubits. Maybe IBM already before, but they already only announced a little bit less in 25 already, in 2025. In the moment for the universal quantum computers, you have IBM Eagle with 127 qubits right here. And yeah, publicly available for free are in most times something like 15 qubits or something like that, which you can use freely, maybe not all the time, only a few times, but for testing purposes, you can use that. And for the other, maybe you must contact IBM, Google, and so on. If you have interesting problems to solve, then maybe they give you access also to their latest quantum computers. But we should also not take attention to IBM, Google, and so on. There are also other competitors which you should also look at. For example, Quantum Brilliance, it's also a partner in our project. They already generate quantum computers which work at room temperature. You know, room temperature. They don't cool it down so much. You don't need so much energy for it because it's operating some laser inside, something like that. That consumes already most of the energy. And they are very small, so they can fit into a server racket. In the moment, they operate only some five-qubit quantum computers, but they claimed something like that, okay, 2025, they will have a quantum computer with something like 50 qubits. So it's already quite well and compatible. And maybe if they use also diamonds, so not natural diamonds, just built diamond inside. If that technology becomes much cheaper, if they can build more cheaper this artificial diamonds, then the supercomputer, the quantum computer of them will be have a much lower price. And that's maybe there's a hope that you can get to some point where you can buy quantum computers for your company, for your university at some point, that it will become cheap enough and do the experiments on top of them. In the moment you have this noisy intermediate scale quantum computers in the range 50-100 qubits, where the noise in quantum gates limits the size of quantum circuits that can be executed reliable. And but if you, for example, look at the summer camp, quantum summer camp of Google or something, you get to know, okay, they are really working hard right here to get fault-tolerant quantum computers. There you need a lot of more physical qubits for one logical qubit, but then you can place many, many gates after each other in a very complex quantum circuit on a quantum computer. And the moment it is limited right here, you can only place relatively small quantum circuits on a quantum computer. And if your quantum circuit exceeds some certain limits, it doesn't run on the quantum computer because the qubits already, there's noise in the quantum gates and the qubits collapse to the basis states already before the computation is over. That's in the moment a very big problem, but there is already theory, okay, if we can get below some certain error correction threshold right here with the physical error rate in our gates, then we can put many, many, many modules with qubits after each other, and then maybe the quantum computer will be big, but we can process then arbitrary large quantum circuits right here. So they say, okay, 100 qubit quantum computers are only an intermediate technology, so there's more to come. And that's very interesting to know. There will be a much bigger future for quantum computers right here. Okay, this slide I will go go over. This shows the suspected shape of the problem class, which can be solved by quantum computers. Just going to the title, we want to discuss, of course, the potential of quantum algorithms. And yeah, for this, you maybe just must look at the quantum algorithm soup. That is, if you just go to it, it's a collection of important quantum algorithms. Oh, where I have it. Okay, it's here, right here. And you see then always, the name of the algorithm, the speed up right here, and a description and a lot of references. So if you search for some important algorithm, maybe this is also an address where you should look at. And it already shows, okay, there are already relatively many algorithms, so 64 they count, but it's not extensive. There are much more outside, but that are the most important ones. The investigated reference are already 430. Number of algorithms, as I said, 64. And very many of them have superponymal speed up. What does it mean? It means that you are almost exponential faster than the best classical algorithm, which is known until now. There are also other speed ups, polynomial, right here as 27. So it looks like super polynomial algorithms are much out there, but if you look at the at the applications, at the at the problems itself, there are many problems which only achieve quadratic speed up, which we will also see later on. So the most important quantum algorithms, you could say, are Shor's algorithm. Maybe you heard it already. It can factorize any number in prime numbers. Right here, it's in a hybrid algorithm. And you can already achieve almost, it's almost exponential faster than the general number field sheaf right here. And this algorithm is very important for cryptography, because in cryptography, for example, you always search for tasks in one direction it's simple, and in the other it's very difficult or very time consuming right here. So many cryptographic algorithms like RSA, for example, are based on the fact that multiplication is a very simple task. And on the other hand, factorization of these numbers, especially if you have here a big prime numbers, so this is also not a good example, because you only have here small prime numbers where you maybe can get the factorization also very easily. But if the prime numbers are very big, then factorization in the other way in the classical world is not easy right here. It's very time consuming, and maybe you need several thousand years to get the solution, and until then all the messages doesn't make any sense anymore for the one who wants to attack you. But they already prepare for when quantum computers can really do this stuff for big numbers. In the moment, they are not suitable for it. So in the moment, all is safe right here, because we don't have very big quantum computers which can handle big numbers right here with Shor's algorithm. But the cryptography researchers, they already prepare for when we get at this point that the quantum computers are powerful enough. And that will be then the post-quantum cryptography, you know? And they develop now cryptographic protocols, which are, that's the clue about it, which are safe even if we have very powerful quantum computers. Shor's algorithm, just to let you know, are based on quantum Fourier transforms, and most quantum algorithms with super polynomial speed up are also based on it. Those who only promise quadratic speed up are based on Grover search. That is the other of the two most important quantum algorithms from, at least according to my opinion. There you can just give a black box function. The user can provide a black box function, which maps from a certain domain to true or false. And with Grover search, you can find one x of that function such that this function for this x becomes true. And that is very powerful because you can give any black box function to it. This is property. And what is done? So on the classical world, if you don't have any knowledge about the Oracle function, about the black box function, then you can just go through the whole domain and check, okay, this, that is all false. Ah, here now I get one solution right here and return it back. So if there's only one solution, maybe you must, something like the half of the domain size, you must go through and get then one solution. But with Grover search, you get that in the square root of the domain size basic steps, basically. Okay, you must multiply it. That is always forgotten by most researchers in their papers. You must multiply it also with the execution time of the black box function. If that is large, then of course, you must also consider that. But basically, you have here the quadratic speed up. And you have many different variations of the Grover search algorithms. I will go into the details also later on. So if there are more than one solution, so for example, k possible solutions, then you can speed up your processing. So you have the domain size divided but by the number of solutions, and there from that the square root that determines the complexity right here. And because it's so simple to give a black box function, it's very often used in very many problems to solve it, and you get then right straight ahead a quadratic speed up in comparison to the classical world. Okay, I already pointed out I'm a database guy originally, and then also moved to the quantum computing area right here. So for me, it was also interesting to know, okay, where I could apply, for example, quantum computing right here. And for example, you can consider query optimization. And maybe you know it already. There are many, many different query optimization approaches in the classical world. It's you just solve mathematical optimization problems with it. And for example, you use dynamic programming. It's quite often used, or simulated annealing, reinforcement learning, random walk, genetic algorithm, Arndt colony optimization, Weyl optimization, integer linear programming, and so on. So many more than are already given here. And what we can see is, okay, these basic Mesicmal optimization approaches are used in quantum or in query optimization right here. And for these are also quantum computer counterparts available. So for dynamic programming, you have a quantum computing counterpart available and so on. Reinforcement learning, quantum machine learning is a bit and hot research topic right here in the moment. You can use that all to apply, for example, in database optimization. And yeah, some of these things are given right here in my lecture. You should look at the slides also, for example, at the last one. There I also make a summarization what else is given there right here and give also some references for it and also before it's relatively straightforward. So I recommend, for example, that you go also on with the lecture slides if you want to dive into some topics in more detail. And yeah, if you look at now at the what we could use in database optimization, where we can use quantum computation, then of course there are some open challenges like okay, this or that quantum computing counterpart, is it suitable to speed up databases? It must be checked in detail, something like that. What should be the properties of a quantum computer, like number of qubits, latency of gates to achieve certain speed ups right here? How to combine classical and quantum computing in hybrid approaches such that not so many qubits are consumed, such that you can use it already in today's quantum computers, and what are other database domains right here. I will later on show optimization of transaction schedules for it. So that are then some basic questions, and I got funding for a project right here. It's called QC4DB, Accelerating Relational Database Management System via Quantum Computing. It has started already. It's funded by the German government, BMBF, something like 3 years, about roughly 2 million euros. And it has especially this topic, query optimization, optimizing transaction schedules. And I'm the coordinator of this project. The era of hardware acceleration of databases and quantum brilliance that were the guys with room temperature diamond quantum accelerators are also another partner right here. And we are open for collaborations such that maybe if you want to also make research in these areas, just contact me and we will look if we can do something together right here. So collaborations are highly welcome because it's a huge topic and maybe we can join our efforts right here by developing quantum circuits for this or that, with this or that approach, and can write joint publications on if there are good results for it, something like that. And on the other hand, if you are in the moment thinking about doing your PhD in this or that area, I have still an open position right here, but the deadline for job applications is quite close. So in 31st of July, so that is only 3 days later, the deadline is over for this job position, for this job offer right here. But if you are interested, of course, you are welcome to apply. I can give you the link. Just contact me. Here's my email address, gruppe@ifesunilubeck.de. So, set, set. Yeah, now coming back to the main problem, which we want to discuss right here. Of course, we are again in competition with other types of database management systems, if we look at it, and we are now in the area that I would say, or I would classify the quantum computing approach just right here as hardware-accelerated database management systems in the parallel area, because we can use the quantum computer to achieve some certain speed up by in parallel looking at a lot of solutions right here. I will propose two ways right here so that you can see that quantum algorithms can be especially solved in many different ways. I think I have to speed up a little bit the presentation. So what's the main point is here that if you have a client, then or if you have a database management system, you have many clients, they deliver transactions. So that is a series of queries with updates and read queries right here to one database server in the traditional sense, or on a cluster. We just look here in that we have a single CPU right here, a parallel system maybe. And then you do, for example, optimize the transaction schedule. That means arrange the transactions in a certain way such that they are later processed more faster than just processing them without ordering these transactions. The first approach would be to use a quantum annealer, and later on I will show how to use quantum, a universal quantum computer for it. And the main point is here that we consider transactions here by that they preclaim their locks at once and also holding all locks until end of the transaction. So we use a strict conservative two-phase locking protocol. And that simplifies a little bit, but it's already complicated enough. Of course, you can look if it is general enough and so on. You can pre-compute transactions to get the locks or something like that if you don't know them before. But in many times, you knew the data objects which you must lock right here. And if you think about this optimization of transaction schedules, then, as I said, you maybe have many different transactions. They're given here as colors. And you have cores of a multi-core CPU. A three-core CPU, very seldom, but I use it here as example. And you can arrange here the transactions such that they are processed very quickly. Here, only 9 time units are consumed. And those which block each other, so for example, the queen and this red one, this one and this one, are not processed in parallel. So that means they can just run and they don't must wait for each other. And this problem, how to arrange these transactions such that they are consumed or such that they are processed very fast, that is, you can see it as some variant of the job schedule problem. It's very often examined in the literature. Right here, with additionally that the blocking transactions should not process in parallel. And from this job schedule problem, we already know it's among the hardest combinatorial optimization problems, such that hardware isolation of the optimization of transaction schedules becomes meaningful. That's the point there. quantum annealing. I already pointed it out in the beginning of the talk. There you can provide a cost function, and as a result, you get the global minimum. It's in oversimplified words, you can do basically the same as with simulated annealing. There you also give a cost function and you get global minimum. But there are other effects like the quantum tunnel effect, something like that, which where we'll get better results for with quantum annealing right here. And you can get that very quickly. It's often said in literature, you must do the quantum annealing slowly enough, but that is only some few nanoseconds. And then you already have one shot, and of course you must have several shots, maybe 100, because of noise and so on, to get the global minimum. And with that, it's a very basic entry into quantum computer, because by quantum annealing, you must just formulate your problem as quadratic unconstrained binary optimization problem. And what does it mean? It means that you have binary variables. They're only 0 or 1, can be only 0 or 1. And you can combine them, or you can give some weights to each of the binary variable. So negative or positive weights. And you can give negative or positive weights for a combination of two binary variables. And the overall sum here is to be minimized and can be minimized by running them on a quantum annealer. That's the point. And then you can formalize your problem. It's given right here with an example. I will not go into a detail of it because of the time. And with that, you can show that or get the solution. You can say then, for example, okay, you have a binary variable, X, I, J, S, as parameters, you could say. And that is one if transaction KY started at time S on machine MJ, otherwise 0. And with that, you can show, okay, what we use here, X230, that is transaction T2 is started at time 0 on machine 3. So that is then this one, and so on. And in this way, you will have a solution by looking or formulating your problem in a different way as quadratic binary problem. And then you do something like give a formula for each transaction starts exactly once. It will be like this. Okay, here we have an offset of a number, which doesn't matter, and formulate your problem like transactions cannot be executed at the same time on the same machine. Transactions that block each other cannot be executed at the same time. And you can give some formula for minimizing the maximum execution time. And putting that all together, just that you get an impression, putting that all together, so this subformulas A, B, C, D, putting that all together will minimize your overall problem. And this is a basic example. You see, okay, you get equivalent solutions right here, which are shown right here. And you can really do them on a real quantum annealer, do the calculations. D-Wave provides a cloud access right for it. So I think it's still the same. So the first minute it's free and afterwards too much for our budget. You could say like this, but the first minute is already quite much, because even if you do 100 shots, you are only in some milliseconds, and for some first trials right here and for a research paper, it is often already enough. No. And then you see, the pre-processing time for some certain problems is of course there, because you must build the formula. It's not for free. But then doing the quantum annealing process is always the same constant time. Doesn't matter what formula, if it fits on the system configuration, then you are lucky. If it doesn't fit, of course you can't process, but if it fits, you can do the calculation one time. It's very good. And we already showed that at least in comparison to simulated annealing, already for relatively short problems, we become faster. That's the point. Of course, you can do some further tricks like using pipelining for further speed up, where you already compute the batches of transactions while the previous batch of transactions is already processed and the results are of previous transactions are returned back to the client. So some pipelining process inside that of course further speed ups the processing. And you can already also think about doing some further stuff with it, like some further optimizations of to minimize the overall processing time, to do the initialization of the quantum annealing much faster. But there must be from the hardware, there must be some more tricks done in the moment. We can only cache the subformulas in some certain way. For example, the number of KE machines is fixed and the number of N transactions. Maybe you fix also them and then you can cache subformulas for A, B, and D, and you can also subformulas of C cache, and you just need the length of transactions ordered by length as key, and you get all the stuff. And of course there's the blocking transactions, you must do a little bit more, but you can already get the rule subformulas already prepared much more quickly by caching them. That is maybe one of the tricks for it. That is quantum annealing, but I already promised that we can do also other approaches, many more. I already claimed that maybe in the beginning, you can basically do also the same for optimizing transaction schedules as for query optimization. But you can also, I first want to point out one of the most important approaches right here, Kuva Search, which runs on a universal quantum computer, where maybe we do the same with the pipelining stuff right here. But we do Kuva Search, as I already pointed out, you just must give a black box function and then do Kuva Search with quadratic speed up in comparison to an exhaustive search on a classical computer. And the quadratic speed up doesn't sound much in comparison to exponential speed up right here, but it's already a very big speed up. You can see it in this fissure right here. So over here, this green line is a linear search. And dependent if you know K before in advance, or if it is unknown before, you can achieve different speed ups, which are also given right here. So very interesting, for example, is if you if the number of solutions grows with the domain size, so for example, 5%, it's always the number of solutions are always 5% of the domain size. You have constant time for processing, for solving the problem. So with a known car, you only need 3.5 iterations, something like, or 3 or 4 iterations, where the probability is highest to get the right solution. For randomized 10 iterations, in a deterministic way, 37 iterations, something like that. But even if you, if K is constant, you see, okay, it also doesn't grow so much. So linear search, you always have something about half of the domain size. You must iterate until you find a solution. But instead of 1 million, if the domain size is 1 million, you only have something below 1,000 if you use Groover, but 500,000 for linear search, you know? And there you see, okay, it will be a game changer right here, even with quadratic speedup. And similar it is for another K. Groover search, get from a black box function right here, 1x such that the function is true, and basically it is done with the following quantum circuit. It's given here, and on the left you have silk code, which is also some maybe good way to express quantum algorithms right here. And basically, I also want go through the steps. What is this? Is first it prepares the search space, but by given each solution x, each x right here, which given to the function, the whole domain size, the same probability, just giving by Hadamard gates. You already heard this in the previous tutorial. Afterwards, you just invert the amplitude right here for those where the oracle gives a true, returns a true. So for those x, for example, S1 and S2, where it is becomes true, we invert it. That just given here with some certain trick, with phase kickback and so on, where just it is inverted. And afterwards, you have the diffusion operator. So or one effect what you can see is that the average of amplitudes of all solutions is a bit little bit lower down. And afterwards, you do the diffusion operator. It looks like this, where you do the reflection around the average. So you flip again this around the average, and all the probabilities of the other solutions becomes a little bit lower. That is done basically right here. And the point is here that you now have a little bit higher probability to get the solutions right here if you measure. Here it's a little bit too much, I would say. It looks like you only need one iteration, but you must do some more iterations typically right here, as we already pointed out, square root of domain size divided by k iterations to get the highest probability right here that the solution will be returned back. And okay. I will overjump. I jump over the analysis why we need this number of iteration. You can look into it into the original paper right here, or Qiskit textbook, or the papers for K solutions, which are all given right here in the below. And if you then think about this Groover search, then of course you can think about that was the algorithm for where you know before the number of solutions. If you then think about how you can extend Groover search, then you just apply Groover search with a different K. You just go first N, and then every time make half of the previous solutions until you get really a solution. You get then always, you run Groover search with k is equal to zero first, then half of n and something like that, half of the domain size, and check if you really get a solution. And yeah, because the number of iterations don't need to be exactly hit, or you don't need to exactly get this iterations to get a solution back. It can be, yeah, in the area of, you know, in the area nearby is also enough. If you have one or two iterations less or more, it doesn't matter. Nearby is also much, but you also cannot, or it is also not like this, that if you use more iterations, you surely get the answer. That's also not the case, because then the probabilities will be lowered back again. You thought about the Bloch sphere, where you have the rotations in the Bloch sphere. There you see, okay, the probability will be higher, but if you do again the iterations, then the probability will become lower again. So that's why you must be about in the number of iterations, but only in the area of approximately the number of iterations to get the solution with high probability. And that's why you can feed in different number of iterations, and you really get then, yeah, you really get then the solution out of it. There is also a randomized version of this. This is the deterministic version, and of course you have only a probability for success, but never 100 percentage, so maybe you must call this method several times and so on, but typically you very quickly get the solution. Okay, that is a randomized version. I will jump over it. There's also some contribution which say that you have the optimal runtime complexity of Groover search already with these approaches, up to a subconstant factor. We are already optimal for it. And Groover search is then used in very many basic algorithms, like solving the collision problem, finding minimum, dynamic programming, solving NP-complete problems, by performing exhaustive searches over the set of possible solutions, for example, KZ, and so on. Of course, you must remember it results in quadratic speed up over classical solutions. So it's not a polynomial time solution for NP-complete problems, because this exponential speed up is not reached. So there, you don't have the hope that Groover search can solve then, can solve very quickly NP-complete problems, but not with polynomial time. That's the point right there. And you can also apply Groover search by finding the minimum by just randomly choose one X in the domain, get a threshold by an initial threshold by applying the function, and then feed in an oracle function where you say, okay, it's true if the function is below a given threshold right here. So this function fx now returns some cost or something like that. It's a cost function, and the oracle function is, okay, this cost functions below, checking for below, that it is below a given threshold. And with that, you get also in a one-time complexity, square root of n, basically. It's another factor, but basically square root of n, you also get the solution right here. You can also analyze it by this paper from Dürr and Hoare. And yeah, with that finding minimum, you can also feed in or look at our optimizing transaction schedule problem, where you have the transaction lengths and the conflicts as input, generate the black box function. And at the same time, you can have an estimator for the number of solutions based on these two, feed these two into Kruva search and get the solution. You must only have a coding scheme of the solution, which, yeah, where you have a number, and this represents the transaction schedule. And basically, you can do this by using some bits for the permutation and for some for separators. Right here, the permutation of transactions. You can use it right here. I also don't want to go into the details because of the time right here, but there is some certain way, some algorithms coming from a number to a permutation, and this permutation of transactions, yeah, you must know, okay, these transactions are processed on this core and these are on that core and so on. Maybe the separators you can still also avoid. That is some improvement on that. Maybe you only need the transaction, but have a certain deterministic way to assign it to the cores. But that's it. And you need then something like, yeah, number of cores minus one logarithmic from number of transaction minus one plus n square for the number of permutations right here, and number of permutations of number of transactions minus one logarithmic for that. So many qubits you must use for it. And that is then the domain size of the black box function and determines the runtime of Kruva search for it. And with that, you can do some analysis. I must also jump over it. And then you can do analysis about the pre-processing time, the execution time, the space cost, and the code size, and compare it with exhaustive searches on CPU, on the quantum computer, and quantum annealing, and you see that you have different, different performances on each of these systems, and maybe can choose the best suitable for your problem right here. And a last point which I want to point out before I want to close the session and come to the Q&A. Is that you don't even every time maybe need to get the very best solution, but maybe a very close to the best solution. And with that, you can even speed up Kruva search more, even more. Like for example, if you only want to get 25% best comparison to the best solution right here, the number of solutions increases much more. It's also shown on this slide right here. And because the number of solutions is much more right here, you speed up also Kruva search. And so you have a trade-off, okay, how much time you need for Kruva search and how close to the best solution you can get right here. And that's also very interesting that you have also these possibilities. So in summary and conclusion, we determined or we discussed scheduling transactions as variant of the job problem with additionally considering blocking transactions. It's a hard combinatorial optimization problem. So hardware acceleration in form here with quantum annealers and quantum computers are very promising to solve these problems right here. For quantum annealing, you have to formalize the transaction schedule problem as quadratic unconstrained binary optimization problem, and then that's it. You have constant execution time, but a relatively high pre-processing time, which maybe you can optimize further with caching of subformulas. And with Groover search, you can go to the universal quantum computers, get a quadratic speed up on the universal quantum computers, and you can estimate the number of solutions for further speed up. Then again, right here, code generator is available. I'm open for collaboration and open now for your questions.
Participants, anyone who is ready, please ask.
So when it was really a deep insight into the transaction processing using the quantum, you have really given a very detailed.
Yeah, thank you very much. It is a little bit heavy. I could not get into all details because that would even take more time. But you have to, the slides can look at it. And I could get a good overview about the steps. And from my impression, it's according to my opinion, it's very good to see different approaches for the same problem on different types of quantum computers. That's what I wanted to show. And also it's maybe a good way to get into the topics that you see, okay, Groover search, for example, if on a classical computer you need exhaustive searches, you can speed up the mathematical optimization problems. If you have somewhere mathematical optimization problems, you can go deeply into it, and the quantum computer can help you solving the problems much faster than before. That's the point, what you could get right here. And maybe get a feeling
absolutely.
Already.
Yeah, you have given ample information for anybody to get into the research and how they should carry out the experiments and what can be expected when they have to write the paper and do their research.
No? Especially comparative analysis of complexity analysis, complexity, runtime complexity. That gives a definitely insight that how much speed up you'll be getting after using the quantum algorithms.
Yeah, because this is the main USP of the quantum, because of which the whole world is after quantum, that we are going to speed up the task. So what it is actually happening when we are doing the research, how much we are able to escalate, right?
And exponential speed up you get for some certain problems.
Yeah.
A quadratic speed up you get for many problems. That you must have in mind right there.
And that
is what you can expect right here, but you can also must look, okay, this get a feeling for these problems can be solved by a quantum computer very good. And these maybe I go to GPU clusters or something like that.
So you are actually working on the quantum computers. You have some access to it, or you're doing on Qiskit, or?
Yeah, that is another question. Of course, if you have access to Qiskit and so on, so the freely available quantum computers, anyone has access. So something like up to 15 qubits computers, you can freely access. Maybe not extensively. That if you have so many jobs, there are, I think, a number of jobs which you can do for free, but it's already quite high. And for research, it's already quite well. You can go for it. And we are, as I shown, we have a partner, this Quantum Brilliance. They also have quantum computers, so we will also go. In the moment, we didn't go for it until now, but we will go sometime later also for their quantum computers and measure their the speed ups. But first, it will be simulation, because there you get to know, does it work in principle, something like that. You can also add noise to the simulation such that you already can check, is it realistic right here that it runs on a real quantum computer? So the different vendors make very much efforts. For example, Google also with Cirque, they have this quantum virtual machines where you can have the detailed noise of specific quantum computers like Sycomore, you know? And of course, the simulations are done on GPU, but the noise model is relatively good, such that maybe with a good, with a good probability, if it runs in the quantum virtual machine with the properties of Sycomore, it would run also on Sycomore in reality when you really go to Sycomore. So something like that, or another quantum computer. That is the effort what they do in the moment. And of course, if we come to fault-tolerant quantum computers of arbitrary size, then it will be again different, because as I said, if the quantum circuits become too large, they don't run on the quantum computer anymore. We will not get results for it. That's one thing. So you can check that in COV before, something like that, with also simulations up to 27 or something, what is realistic to run on GPUs. And that you can do in COV. And of course, there must be the test on real quantum computers that you are sure that it will work also today on today's state-of-the-art quantum computers. And you can use it already and get certain speed-ups for it. And that is then the other thing. And in the moment, for real-world applications, in most times, you can only show small problem sizes. That is a little bit frustrating. You could say that it runs on real quantum computers, but there are application areas which would also relatively work well. So quantum machine learning works well, but of course, there you only do the model on the quantum computer, the computation of the model on the quantum computer, something like that. And you have for certain data, you have speed up in learning, something like that, what is already shown, but that is other stuff. And for certain data sizes, you get a quantum advantage.
Yes.
But they in most times show it only theoretically, but not practically with real world data sets.
But
it's now the point where you can show, research is always like this. You must look for what goes and what doesn't go. You must extend the limits of research right here. And now it's really fascinating times with quantum computing, because if they really get now in the next decade the quantum computer, the fault-tolerant quantum computer running, then it really, maybe you are one of the first who applied this or that problem to quantum computing, for example. And so there you get some reputation On the other hand, of course, it's all not without risk, because it will be still very difficult, although shown, okay, this and that error threshold must be there, and then we can get fault tolerant quantum computing. It's very difficult for them to achieve that goal. Otherwise, they would have already done. They are still confident. If you speak with physicists working in that area, but it is very, very difficult to get that. And so there is a risk. Maybe the quantum computer still doesn't succeed. You know, it's still, the probability is still there. And if that is like this, then you have done theoretical research, but you never know. Maybe 300 years later, they will get it, and then you were then the first. but of course, it's not in your lifetime.
Yeah, hopefully.
Okay, are there any other questions or remarks?
So, Sam, it's a very wonderful session. Thanks for the wonderful session. Anyone who wants to share his or her knowledge, any comments, any remarks? Can we have one pic? All are requested to please on your cameras. Can we have one pic? Okay, thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you too for your invitation.
Okay, nice. Hope you will have nice vacation.
Yeah, thank you very much. If anything is there else, you can contact me via email for collaborations or other stuff.
So have you ever been to India?
Yes, I was there 2 times.
2 times, which all places you have visited so far?
Hyderabad, there was, it's a long time ago, the WWW conference.
Okay.
There I was, and Nitka Suratkal, there I was also giving a summer school about semantic web. It's also a long time ago.
So you have come, you had come only for purpose.
For what?
Only for purpose you have come to attend the conferences. And
so you haven't been to any tourist places?
It was then near to these areas. I was not there as a tourist until now, or poorly as a tourist. You know, I was going to conference, and one time I give a summer school right there, and there were in the evening or over the weekend there was some free time to visit some places there. But it was not like this, that I was in India only as a tourist and then spent 1-2 weeks or something like that in India for. But it's a very different to Germany, also culture, many different religion and so on.
So yeah. There is one query.
Okay. I see it. So from Nasa Tarini, the query is there. Please, Prof, do you think using quantum through algorithms will be able to develop new skills in our learning processes? That's a difficult question. So learning processes in education, in university, or do you mean in quantum machine learning? What's these two things are there? So one thing is, okay, with quantum circuits, the theory of quantum physics, and so on. Of course, it's a very different way to teach these concepts and to get many other things to in your brain, you know. It's so it's very useful, even if you don't go for quantum computing. Yes, especially in order to enhance critical thinking. So that is one thing, that it's a new type of thinking right here. If you go for quantum computing right here, if you think about this, yeah, social stuff, critical thinking, and so on, of course you can discuss about quantum computing, about how many funds are spent right here for quantum computing. All this stuff could be also thought about. If would it better to solve other crises? Maybe there is no outcome. Maybe GPU clusters are already enough. Of course, climate change and so on. In the moment, I don't think we will change climate because we have later on quantum computing running very fast and running very big quantum circuits or something like that. I don't believe this. So that is especially one point. So these social aspects, these cultural aspects, and all other stuff about how we, for which we spend money and so on, is also another stuff which should be discussed right here, where we should spend money for it. Even just like we can do quantum computing, is that enough? Something like that for a reason that we go on and spend millions or billions of euros and US dollars and whatever right here in which currency for quantum computing. Is it to grow our own reputation? As I said before, maybe we are the first to invent some new algorithm or apply this or that to quantum computing and get a high reputation for it. Is that also enough reason to go for it? Or is it much better to solve other real problems in the world? Of course, we can discuss, there will be better weather models or something like that with quantum computing. Can be arranged, all these thoughts are in my brain, and that is, of course, an open question right here. I hope that answers your question. I think I, according to the comment, this question is maybe not answered fully right here, but I can give some thoughts right here. And maybe everyone in the summer school can also think about this or that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, bye.
So this we end with the today's session. So tomorrow's session again will start with 10 a.m. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.